All right, bravo, bravo.
Thank you so much. You're really
So
kind.
you wore all the hats. Okay. I saw Chow Chen here earlier, but I don't think he's here anymore. Yeah, that's okay.
That's a shame.
Yeah, that's all right. He was he did costume photography and a whole lot more, so
That channel was really great in his interpretation, in my opinion, of the mask salesman. It was really in tuning with the
yeah,
character.
definitely.
Really enjoyed his performance.
The masks, they were all custom made, right?
Masks, yeah, they're all custom made. I made them by myself.
Okay. And but the ocarina itself, did you have to buy that yourself, or did you actually like?
Now the ocarina, I purchased it, and then I recorded the sounds while playing a side-blown flute or a synthesizer and mixing them to achieve these sounds that recall an high flute or something similar to the ocarina. I play several instruments, but not the ocarina. So you need to study it.
Okay, so a lot of the music was, oh, this was played? Like they you guys actually like, played that yourself, or you didn't take anything
Yeah,
from the.
I played quite all the music of the film, except for the Lost in the Woods theme that is the one of the last 3 minutes before the ending titles, in which I play side-blown flute and keyboard, and other my friends from the marching band from Casanudada play other instruments. And for the remaining part of the movie, I played the piano for the attic scene, the one with the character of Andrew, with the wedding dress, and the other stuff. And then I play guitar in some of the other tracks. And most of the time, I use a keyboard and synthesizer with software to fake sounds of other instruments.
Okay, it's wonderful. The software you use for the animation, like what did you use?
The animation, I used a software called IPsoft. That allowed me to use to Kinect depth sensor to record motion capture. That I spent maybe $20 to purchase this sensor, and then I edited the recording data in another software like Maya and Blender to correct some imperfection of the recording. Because there was a low budget hardware, so yeah,
Yeah.
sort of limitations on it. But I'm
Okay.
pretty happy with the results.
I
I also
mean,
used some animation from a service by Adobe called Mixamo that allowed you to upload a character and get a base rigging, sorry, of the character that allowed you to match it with a series of free animations that I re-edited after this matching between characters and rigging. On another situation, I made the rigging by myself.
oh wow, well done, sir. I mean, who were in the suits? Like, to do the mocap?
To do the mocap, I played part of the motion capture along with my friend Vittorio Pugliese, that is a real fan of the Zelda series since we were kids. So he was really happy to play his part. Even he have a little cameo inside the movie. He's the guy who drink that sort of something inside that glass along with Cafe in the nightmarish scene.
So, it's lovely. In building the whole world, did you use a template?
The most iconic part, I mean, for example, the entrance of the Woodfoot Temple, I modeled and textured this piece by myself, like for other kind of elements, like the entrance of the Stone Tower Fortress, and some other the traps inside the temple, and other all the characters I modeled by myself. And for other part of the setting of the world of to recreate the world of Termina, I used some assets I purchased on Real Engine Marketplace, and Real Engine was really played the lion's share in the making of the animated sequences. It's really an incredibly powerful tool because it allowed me to recreate in the rendering in a lifetime. not like using a standard rendering software that it would be really hard to achieve this kind of result, especially because it's a movie of quite 2 hours. So it was really, really helpful to use Unreal Engine. Yeah.
That's fantastic. It's fantastic. How long did the rendering take?
The rendering actually takes just a few minutes per shot.
Yeah.
And so it was really easy to check in real time what I was doing inside the software with all the lightening and rendering effects in real time, and without waiting, for example, 2 hours to see one frame and discover it's not good, you need to remake it. So I experienced that for an exam I was doing for my graduation in set design at Brera Academy of Fine Art, in which I had to produce one single frame of a set I was projecting, but it takes 16 hours to get the single frame. So
okay. Let's see. Voice acting. I know, like, everybody practically pitched in. You and I think Francisco did like a whole bunch of other, all the characters.
Really enjoyed making this. Yeah, is a real been watching of all kinds of movie, and they like to imitate characters, you know, and play different. Changing of his voice to play them. So I started asking him to play only the character of the Deku King, but he was really excited about the experience. So I asked him to play also the other characters, and in my opinion, he did really a great job. Was really, really proud of his performance.
Fantastic. I felt like the world was kind of perfect to produce. I was especially where you're coming from, you know. It's, you know, you're in Italy, so it's like the whole world of this version of Zelda, which we don't see Zelda anywhere anyways.
It's the only episode in which Zelda didn't appear.
Should have called it Link.
I think they show her only for a brief sort of flashback in the game, the first time he regained possession of his ocarina, but just for a couple of seconds, I think.
Yeah.
They would have called this title whatever, and it suits.
Just creating Navi. I mean, I know it's like supposed to be a simple character, but did you have to get like a template for that one, or did you actually just create it yourself?
No, I created it in After Effects. I made this sort of light points with a circular mask on which I applied some radiance effects to simulate you know that blinking of the lights, and then I added and animated the wings besides inside a pre-composition in the software, and then I turn it in a 3D layer and move it around to simulate the movement in space.
okay. The green screen that you used, like, it's almost flawless. Like, how big is this green screen that you guys were working
with? I purchased a green screen of, I guess, 6 meters for 3 or 4. And then for some additional sequences, I bought another one to place it on the floor. For example, for the scene with Cafe returning in its hideout, when he's in a totally state of depression and despair, the entire set is recreated in 3D using After Effects and green screen, except for the table and the chair and a couple of other objects.
Okay. I'm American. You said meters, right? 6 meters. Yeah, sorry. No. I don't blame you. I'm looking at it. It's 19.7 feet to us.
Yeah, so, it's like if let's say a person is like a 3-person height of a medium, medium height.
Okay. That's fantastic. So, I'm like losing my train of thought. The actors you actually casted for this, were they already working for you, or? Did you actually cast them independently?
It was a strange series of circumstances, because it started while I was playing in a rehearsal of the marching band of our town, and then this kid passed me by, and it was really perfect to play the role of Link, in my opinion. And the better part is that I wasn't thinking of making a movie yet about Zelda. But then I noticed him, and he turned to be a relative of some other friends of mine playing in the marching band. So I asked them, and I became a friend of him. Yeah, his name Aaron, and it was really patience, really calm, really polite and professional. on set. It's really incredible because he was only 10 years old when we started to shoot this project, and then we made some other scenes after 2 years, so I had to face this problem of growing and aging. Yeah, hopefully not like in old by Night Shyamalan. It would be really a huge problem, but hopefully not. So I had to study a way to explain, to justify this change of aging inside the movie. So at a certain point, I decided to kill the protagonist and return it to a new life, but in a younger likeness.
Oh, so, okay.
I made this little trick to, yeah. I took a bit of inspiration from what Terry Gilliam was forced to do in the Imaginarium of Dr. Parnassus. With the loss of, tragically, loss of Heath Ledger during the production of the movie. And then he was forced to find some other actors to play a missing scene, And yeah. I remember this this kind of situation that inspired me a bit. Hopefully not in a so tragic situation.
No. I mean, it explains how he grew the beard.
Yeah.
Sorry. Bad joke. But speaking of which, was that your beard that the character Cafe actually had? Was this when they turned him young?
That was another friend of mine who played Cafe, his name Paolo Lopumo. I met him in another rehearsal room that I manage as volunteer for the oratory of my town. He had this fantastic drum kit, and he was leaving Milan to settle in Cassano, and he was needing to find a place for these drums. I had this rehearsal room, so we started to talk, and we became friends. And I discovered he was really a huge fan of Majora's Mask, and so I asked him to join the crew. And he played also with green suits, the role of the skeleton king. It was a bit ridiculous while wearing that kind of stuff. So, because it was really covered in green. And it was fun. Probably that was also the most difficult part, technically speaking, of the movie, because I had to match the his movement in the live action shots with the data I recorded for the motion capture, and then match them with the sword and shield that was a real prop and not digital. So it was a bit difficult to manage.
Okay. Well, you guys got through it, so.
Yeah, hopefully, yes.
I'd like to open the table to any questions from our audience, if they're interested. We have the chat room available to anyone. So, okay. When dealing with the photography, did you guys have any issues with that? Because I know you guys had, you're playing with a lot of hues, like very green, very sepia type, scenarios. Was that difficult?
I tried to study in depth before shooting all the different situations we had to manage. I made a storyboard for all the scene, all the shots we need to do, because this was the only way, in my opinion, I would be able to manage this amount of work. And of course, you can plan everything in your mind, but there's always a part of unpredictable things that might occur. So you need to also be open-minded and trying to problem to solve a problem that could happen. For example, I really struggled with the shot with the reflections of Link on the water, because first of all, I had to recreate a little pool with only two fingers of water, because I was trying to reach this kind of realistic distortion results of the image of Link on the surface. But it took maybe an hour to find the correct angle to shoot it. So it was really something I had never imagined. And in general, it was always a good experience, but sometimes we had to shot really a lot of different frames. So for example, the first day we went to shoot in the park of an historical mansion in Monza, with this huge oak tree. And that day we shot maybe 30 different shots, so it was really really heavy, especially for Aaron, because I was only 10 years old, you know. So but he was really great, really calm and focused. I was really astonished by this guy, because it's really impressive.
Okay.
How long did it take you to make?
How long did I take it to make? Actually, I started to make Lost in the Woods as a short film of 15 minutes for my graduation in sub-design, and it took me from September to the first day of April to produce it. But then I had the three more years to achieve this final cut of the movie. So in the end, I took maybe 4 years to make this.
Wow, that's crazy. 4 years. Well done. Well done. Is this fan film still in circulation in the festivals?
Yeah, I started to present it by Film Freeway on different festivals from the first days of June. And now I have some other festivals occurring in the next month. So it's going really, really good till now. So I'm really happy of the results, especially for my friend that allowed me to make this this project that is also based on the meaning of friendship. So I particularly enjoy this experience.
Is there a place to rewatch it? Or are you guys going to repost it at some point?
Sorry?
Is there going to be a place to rewatch it? I wanted to it was stuttering a little bit on my end, so I kind of wanted to see it.
Oh, is it going to be like published on YouTube or Vimeo?
Yeah. Not yet, but I published a preview of the deco scenes part I called it 3 days in Termina a Deku story. This is on my YouTube channel. And also I published a trailer of the film.
Very cool. Thank you.
Okay. I guess we can go right ahead and just put it on the chat where your website is. Yeah, also just to share it for everybody. It's what was it called? Like Adriano?
AdrianoForte.com. Yes, this is my website. Yeah.
Forte.com. All right. Shared it right there in the chat.
Thank you.
So let's see. I guess before we actually end this interview, why did you decide to do a fan film?
Well, that's an interesting question. You know, I was really amazed by this game since first time I played it when I was a kid of 10 years old. I was really astonished by the atmosphere, the music, and also the topics it talks about, and that was something that I feel really related to. Also the research of one's own identity and role in society, and the way we face grief or the loss of a beloved one. That is one of the main topics at the base of the storytelling of Lost in the Woods, and at the same time of Majora's Masks. And it had its roots in the ancient historical origins of fairy tales. I did a research for my graduation in set design on these topics, because I was really fascinated about this willing of mankind to project something in a theatrical or a scenographical way, something with imaging related to our imaginary, but also with sounds, and it was also in ancient times connected with a ritual of acceptations of new members of the tribe of this clan of hunters. That also a way art was intended as a way to explain reality, but also unknown things. For example, the mystery of death. And I found that it was really, really cool to connect all this path with the story of Majora's Mask. That is really awesome to me.
Awesome. Fantastic. Well, Ozis, what would you say to people that are aspiring to be filmmakers? I know a majority of them, when they get in, it's a big shock. It's a lot of work.
Yeah, that's a lot of work, but if you keep up with passion, you certainly succeed in the end. Sometimes it's not easy. It's like a roller coaster. Sometimes you are really happy and proud of yourself. Sometimes you feel really sad and depressed, especially when things doesn't work as expected. But you have to keep calm, keep focused, and maybe try to watch things by different perspectives. Because sometimes maybe you think that doing something in a certain way it suits you, but sometimes it's not. Sometimes you should try to do things a little bit differently, and be open-minded and trying to look others' work to find some inspiration from this other way to make movies, to make art in general. That's it.
Well, speaking of that, actually, I have a question. Like, do you, like, was it hard for you when collaborating with people and losing your vision for the sake of improving the movie? Like, have you ever gone through that process?
Well, while doing the movie, I manage almost all the role of the production. So I hadn't had to, in this case, to deal that much with others, but I tried to give everybody enough room to express themselves, not to force them to do something they don't feel it was good for them, and also be open to suggestions. And yeah, I mean, I think that listening is the more important aspects of a good director, in my opinion, because you have your own idea, you have your vision, you are focused, you know maybe a lot of stuff about the technical issues and probably, but sometimes someone who didn't have this kind of knowledge has a fresher view of some aspects, and it could be really helpful to listen. And it was really important to me in the process.
Fantastic. If there are no more questions, to Adriano here, I would like to thank you. Thank you so much for that lovely
thank you so much. It was really a pleasure to me. Thanks again.
Yes, of course.